In today's manufacturing world, efficiency is king. We're always looking for ways to reduce our setup times, to minimize cycle time so we can get parts out the door faster. But look, that's gonna come with a lot of work. It's gonna come with a lot of your time. And let me tell you, those machines out there in your shop, those carousels are gonna be packed. You're gonna have hundreds of tools scattered around your shop, all for different features, for tackling different materials, different parts. That's gonna drive up some cost, especially if you're a small to medium-sized business. So what can we do? What can we try to go after? We can try to figure out a way to do more with less. We can figure out how we can attack multiple operations with fewer tools. We can try to find a single cutter body and make it the multitasker in our shop. That's why I'm here at the MSC Machining Research Laboratory in partnership with the University of Tennessee at the Tennessee Manufacturing and Design Enterprise. And we have some metalworking experts in this house, Seco and the How-To team. They're gonna be helping all of us learn how to maximize tooling versatility. So this is Tennessee made, baby. I like it.
Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely, we're glad you're here.
Give me the rundown on what this space is. Where are we at?
Yeah, we're at the Tennessee Made, which is part of the Institute for Advanced Materials and Manufacturing at the University of Tennessee. Mm-hmm. This whole place is all about innovation and working with industry to grow research that's been done at the university and put it out in the field. We want to get things that have been highly developed by our graduate students and our faculty into the hands of the job shops so that they can improve their processes in the long run.
And how does this space interact with the industrial community, with those job shops? Are they allowed to come in here in any way, or do they? How do they interact with you?
Yeah, there's a couple different ways they can interact with us. First is through research with faculty members. That's a really traditional way to work with us in the university. But we have a new way, and that's actually through co-locating with us here at Tennessee Made. We can work with you to have some square footage where you can either place a machine or part of a line or whatever you're working on so that you don't have to shut down your production, and you can mess around, try different things out, do some research, and then take that back to your job shop at the end of the day and implement it into your everyday workflow.
Yeah, Tyler, my brother in blue, the MSC crew. So what do you do here at Tennessee Made?
Thanks, Jacob. Well, as MSC, Ross and I are here to represent our company to really be the boots on the ground to work on metalworking research, testing, and some technology development. You know, we want to cover the whole span from every single one of our industrial partners, like Seco, and we'll see some machining later on, but we want to make sure we bridge the connection between academia, as well as research, and what we can provide for our customers so that they can optimize their process and get to the solution that they need.
Nice. I'm excited to be a part of the crew. I'm excited to get to visit this facility, and mentioning Seco, I think I see him down there waiting for us. You guys mind if I go head down there and get to cutting?
Head on.
All right, man. We got a lot of tools going on today.
Thanks, Jacob. Well, I'm here to show you the next generation Octomill 06. This is the latest release from Seco Tools for our indexable milling products. One of the great things about the Octomill 06 that we've actually introduced is a new connection on the pocket that has not only secured the insert, but it's also enabled us to provide more than just Octomill inserts in this cutter body. Right now, if you notice, we have a moderate high feed insert, and we can also install a round insert in the same cutter body as well.
So this is an interesting concept. So indexable milling, right? A lot of people, when you're doing features on your part, you have to have your roughing end mill, your semi-finisher, your finisher, your drills, your taps. You have all these tools that do a very specific job. Something that's, and I'm speculating here, something that's interesting about this is the fact that you can put in multiple types of inserts easily on this one body that can hit those different types of features of what? Maybe roughing, semi-finishing, finishing, something like that.
This is a great cutter, very versatile for all customer applications. We can also run all material groups from steel to stainless steel to super alloys and aluminums.
What is your perception on of what it means to the actual
user out there, to the machine shop, if you had to sum it up in just one, two sentence, what's your thing you want people to know?
Absolutely. What I would say is this is going to be a great capital investment for our customers. They can purchase one tool to do many, many jobs, and that's going to be something that's going to be more economical for them in the future.
Oof. If we're talking about capital investments, sometimes I like to represent the industry when we're talking about spending that money. I don't spend any of my money until I see something in action. You mind if we get this going?
Let's go.
All right, Ross,
it's time to see some chips flying. I'm ready to see this going. What do you got for us?
All right, so I have the moderate high feed insert set up into the Octomill, and we're just gonna rough case the top of this 4140 block.
Nice. I'll
get that going.
Great, good point. So what speeds and feeds are you running on this?
So we are feeding at 178 inches per minute. We're spinning at 1400-ish RPM. We're going about 55 foul depth of cut.
Nice.
1.5 inches. That's our step over.
Nice. What's that spindle load at too?
The spindle load is about 100%, so we're getting solid capacity there. So really maxing out the spindle.
I'm excited. Look at that beauty. Let's get the doors open.
This right here, even though it's rough as heck, those chips were coming off like little dimes, like little nickels.
Yeah, nice heat in there and the chips, in the actual chips. And I think that's a big thing too when you're doing cutting like this, doing roughing at that type of speed of depth. It's making sure that the heat's going to your chips, not to your inserts or to your part.
Right, what do you think about it, dude?
Absolutely, what you're looking for, that blue color, because it's 4140 steel, so it's a nice bedding steel, but you want to put all that heat into the chip, and you'll notice that the chip will turn actually a little bit blue, and that's giving you a good indication that that heat is going into that chip.
So you're about to see some more chips fly, a little thicker cut. We're gonna get after it. We're doing a semi-finishing pass though, right, Jay? But you said it was a thicker cut?
What I wanna show you is the same facing path we had done before. Uh-huh. Now, instead of using the moderate high feed inserts, which is a great insert for this style machine, where you can't maybe use the same high feed inserts that other machines can use, the moderate high feed works great for that. But now we're gonna be using a standard traditional octo insert.
Oh, that's right, we switched our inserts.
At a larger depth of cut, a slower feed rate, but you're gonna get a similar metal removal rate.
Nice.
Oh yeah, you hear that sound difference. It's a little bit deeper sound now, and you see the depth of cut change that we have in there.
Yeah, we're running 110 thou rather than 55, so we almost doubled, that.
Okay.
A spindle speed is about the same. We're about almost 1300 RPM. Yeah. But like Jay had said, we slowed it down a lot. So now we're running at 63 inches per minute.
And interestingly enough too, our spindle speed dropped down probably around what, the 85s maybe?
Yeah,
maxing
yeah,
out at the 85?
The spindle load dropped a little bit.
Nice.
So when this finishes, we're still gonna see, because this was still a roughing operation, we're still gonna see, I mean, dude, still a cold part.
Yeah.
That is awesome. But we're
going to notice that surface finish looks a little bit better than it did with the moderate high feed insert.
Yeah. At least more consistent.
Yeah, absolutely.
But now what we're going to move on to, let's see if this thing, I mean, still not hot, you know? I'm going to take this out. We're actually going to switch to now we're doing a finishing pass.
Now we're going to do a finishing pass.
All right. How many times am I going to have to close these doors today? Jay, we got another tool path coming up. We got another feature getting shown. What are we attacking?
All right, so now we're actually gonna run a similar insert that we had before.
Okay,
so it's the same insert size, but this had the same insert edge, but this one is actually a wiper insert compared to the other one, which did not have the wiper insert on it.
Okay.
And the main reason we're running this is to show the flexibility where you can choose different inserts with different features that change the operations that you have on the part.
Nice.
Hey, Jake, can you clarify real quick? You say you got wipers in there. How many wipers do you have in the cutter?
That's actually a really good question right there. This is not a dedicated wiper. Mm-hmm. This is an integrated wiper. So every insert actually includes a wiper feature on there. Now, we do have dedicated wiper options. That is something we can do. But again, it depends on your part requirements. It's flexibility and versatility that we offer the Octo 6 to get that for you.
So now we're gonna get to the point where we're actually seeing some nice finishes,
yeah,
correct?
Absolutely.
And still dry, which yeah. I think is, I honestly, for a lot of like steels and things and certain exotic materials, when you can do it, obviously can't do it for all, but I
think that cutting dry, depending on your depth of cut and your feeds, you'll get a nicer finish, because it's almost, to me, I feel like because of how much heat you're transferring to those small chips, it's like they're burning off instead of getting cut off, and I think it leaves a nicer finish.
Our recommendation from a tool life standpoint, if you're running steel forks with Seco grades, always run your tool, your tires.
Nice. And especially not doing any of that, I know this isn't a cooling video, but just for the information out there, so all you know, doing that flip and switch, like where you're like, cooling on, cooling off, cooling on, cooling up. Is that
shocking?
Is that actually bad for the inserts?
That is bad for the inserts. That's what we call thermal cracking or thermal fracturing the inserts. Hot, cold, and will result in actual physical cracks that you can see on the insert if you do run the operation like that.
Let's get in here and look at this a little bit. Nice. Yeah, now you're starting to see that. That is so clean.
Real nice surface finish on there. And that's it. And that's utilizing that wiper. Just make sure when you do that, you'll make sure that your feed per tooth is less than the wiper edge that you have on the insert.
Interesting.
And that's going to give you a real nice cut.
We're going to dive into one more operation, correct? We're going to switch these out for a different type of insert entirely?
Yeah, so primarily what we've been doing so far is just roughing with a facing style insert with a moderate high feed. Then we use two different styles of the Octo 6 inserts. But again, this cutter can use different style inserts. Now we're going to put a button cutter insert in there, a rounds insert, and we're going to do some profile.
So this is the last time that I'm closing those doors. Hopefully, this is the last stop. Jay, what do we got going on?
All right, so talking about versatility, talk about flexibility, talk about different things that we can do with this cutter. Mm-hmm. So now we're putting round inserts in there.
Okay.
So with a round insert, I really have a wide range of operations that I can do. I can do anything from a facing path, a high feed path, or a profiling path. And so 3D cutting is what we're going to try now.
So we've hit the roughing. We've hit two roughing passes. We've done finishing.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, nice. We're about to do some profiling, all with the same cutter, but with different cutters, different inserts.
And that's what's really great about this, is it gives you the flexibility of choosing the insert that you need for your operation, whether you're roughing, or you're finishing, or you're profiling.
Let's take a look at this one. That pattern is crazy.
Yeah, that's due to the feed ring that we're running, and you see just how fast we were running.
We were finished still, too. I mean, you consider that a roughing.
That's a rough pass.
Yeah. And it looks that good. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Let's see. How are we feeling up here? I mean, that is still, there hasn't been any point where, obviously, I wouldn't hold this for too long, but still tapping it like this, not that bad.
We want to make sure we run our feeds and speeds so that we're running all that heat into the chip.
Two sides of the same cutter. We have had a lot going on today. There's been different inserts, there's been different features, different feeds and speeds. We're gonna bring that all home for you right now. Mike, what do we got going on over here?
Well, basically, kind of what Jay was talking about earlier, the versatility, but I mean, roughing, you know, in this type of machine, you gotta have the right cutter, and I think this gives you a nice combination of ability for both roughing, and I know I'm talking roughing, but he's going to be talking finishing, but it gives you the ability to do both.
Nice.
And so by having that versatility and be able to run this in a smaller machine or something, you know, that's like a Cat 40, I think is ideal. And as we saw, you can get very aggressive with the
roughing,
so that's a key for your productivity. Yep.
Jay,
yes, sir.
What you have on your side, that was a lot more of the finishing, and then when we really started to take a turn and switch out inserts entirely, correct?
Yep, absolutely. So over here, we ran the Octo 6 inserts with the wiper insert at a lower feed rate. Mm-hmm. We're about 4 thou per fluid on that one, about 10 thou depth of cut, and that left us a really nice finish, and so it showed the versatility of using the integrated wiper in that insert to achieve that finish as well. But then, like you said, we mixed up entirely, and we put the round insert in there, and that's where we can show where this cutter over here has true versatility of not just doing facing and basic machining operations like that, but we can use this as a 3D profiler, surfacing parts and things like that.
Nice, I appreciate the insight, fellas.
Thank you, Jacob.
At the end of the day, when you're picking a cutter, when you're picking a new tool, it's just to get the job done. You're attacking a part, you're attacking a feature. Do it on the technicality of the cutter. Do it on the logistics of your business. A bustling industry,
a beautiful facility and a tool that we found that can finally help us solve this challenge of how do we do more with less. It was an amazing day today with a lot of different insight, not just from the versatility of tooling, but the versatility of tooling in your shop. The versatility of being able to do more with less, to figure out different ways to fixture, to set up, to attack a part. That was the theme of today, not just how this amazing tool from Seco can replace almost all of this, but it's about how you use that in your shop productively to make it so you can free up space for more jobs on one machine, to get more parts in your facility so you can get more parts out of it. Now, I don't think we need these anymore. I think now we've learned, and hopefully you learned, a little bit more about how to maximize tooling versatility.
For more metalworking tips and industry best practices, stay tuned for the next how-to episode and subscribe to the MSC Industrial Supply YouTube channel, a source of original manufacturing content built to make you better.